My name's Chris Maurer. I live in Houston, Texas. I'm a Republican. I'm a conservative. In fact, I consider Ronald Reagan to be the greatest president in my lifetime, if not our greatest president ever. Even people who disagreed with his policies, I think, respected the fact that, he made it clear what he wanted to do, and he endeavored to do it, and he had a certain amount of respect. I think he was singularly responsible for the fall of the Soviet Union, and I think he did a wonderful job reviving the American economy as well as America's pride and stature in the world. Been like, well, I was a sophomore, so it must have been 19 or 20 at the University of Wisconsin. I just came across an article or something in a textbook on circumcision, and all of a sudden it just dawned on me, what had happened that day back when I was 3 or 4 years old. I'd gone to the public health department for an immunization and heard screaming coming on and on and on. Well, I just remember thinking at the time, boy, that must be really a big kid in there. That must be somebody 10 years old, maybe, because it was just so loud and it went on and on and on. And it was, a large waiting room, and of course, there's the door is shut from where the waiting room adjoins the doctor's offices. And then, down the hall, there was another closed door. So the baby was in the examining room, which door was closed, and then a little hallway, and then that door was closed, and we were out in the waiting room. And it was just a horrific having to listen to that. Finally, the door opened, and a woman walked out carrying a baby in a white blanket, and there were tears running down the mother's eyes as she briskly walked out of the public health department. And it was my time to go in for my immunization, and needless to say, I was a little bit reluctant to walk through the door that the baby had just come out of. And I just was convinced that, that was never going to happen to any baby boy that I had, and it wasn't. See, in 2009, I saw Georgianne Chapin on MSNBC with at the I guess it was the AIDS conference in Atlanta, and she was Nancy Schneiderman, a medical host from MSNBC, was the moderator, and there was a pediatrician, and Georgianne was debating the pediatrician. I thought, well, that's what I've always thought. That's what I've always said in private conversations. And so I started donating a little bit of money to Intact America and to NoCirc, and talked to Marilyn Milos. And I got a call from a friend of mine asking me if I would appear on Fox News, and I said, well, sure. And I'm thinking, well, it must be a week or two from now. And I said, well, when? Well, tonight. That was very odd in retrospect. So the host sat me down at this desk and pointed to this bank of monitors and said, look right here, and we're going to be starting shortly. And then she walked off with the doctor into another room beyond, in another area, the door shut. So I'm sitting there all by myself in this cavernous room, just cooling my heels, sitting there by myself, nervous. And then the monitors all go on, and I'm not quite sure. I'm looking at myself in one monitor, and there's other things that are going on. I'm not quite sure where to look. And 10, 9, 8, 7, et cetera. And all of a sudden, we're on the air, as far as I know.
Circumcision is medically unnecessary, painful, and risky. But some experts say there is a medical benefit. In tonight's Fox and Focus, is there really a need for boys to be circumcised? We're joined by Dr. Stephen Canfield, Program Director of Urology at UT Health Medical School and Chief of Urology at LBJ General Hospital, and also lawyer and child rights activist Chris Maurer. He's from the group National Organization of Circumcision.
Well, we talked in the parking lot for a while. He was actually not really pro-circumcision. He was more or less just circling the wagons and spouting the party line. And he basically made a comment about how on the air about how circumcision decreases the risk of HIV by 50%.
Doctor, I'll give you the last word on this.
Sure. In addition to penile cancer, there's the prevention of the spread of HIV. In fact, three large randomized trials have been done in Africa, which clearly showed when the data was combined that circumcision in heterosexual men reduced the risk of HIV development by 50%. That's huge.
Then out in the parking lot, he said, well, those studies in Africa have no applicability to the United States. And those people in Africa, they've got a tremendous epidemic of AIDS, and they're just grasping at straws, is what he said to me. Then he went on to say that obstetricians have no business doing circumcisions and that performing circumcisions on infants without anesthesia is barbaric. He probably didn't want to offend any of his colleagues there at his hospital. He answered the questions he was asked in his defense. He wasn't asked those questions on the air, but he certainly didn't volunteer that information either. I sent out that video to a lot of clients and associates and family members, and I haven't received any negative feedback from anyone. But I was a little surprised by that, actually. Some of the women in my office were like, well, I had my child when I was 20, and I just didn't know any better, and I was young, and I didn't know anything. They were apologetic about what they had done. So I think it is changing. We teach our kids about peer pressure and if everyone's jumping in the lake with you, but yet a lot of parents don't apply those principles to themselves, at least when it comes to the issue of circumcision. They do it because everybody else is doing it. If an 18-year-old wants to be circumcised, I don't care. That's his business. But this circumcision of minors, to me, is just unacceptable. And these health benefits, if there really are these health benefits, then make that presentation to a person when he's 18. If these benefits really exist, you'll have men standing in line to be circumcised. And quite frankly, I think the reason they do it to babies is because they know they'd never be able to persuade an adult to consent. From what I understand, there's a misrepresentation to men being made that they're receiving a surgical vaccine. And so these men are consenting, but it's based on intentional misrepresentation by these healthcare providers that are receiving massive amounts of funding from the United States government as well as from the Gates Foundation and other private organizations. I like to think that people are well-intentioned and they mean well, that nobody's intentionally pulling the wool over men's eyes, but I don't really know. I think people sometimes get deluded into believing that what they're doing is right without really examining it. And so I can't really speak to the motivation of the pro-circers in Africa. I mean, there is a problem with HIV, obviously, but that's either through abstinence or use of condoms or monogamy. I mean, that's the solution to it, not as the pro-circers jokingly talk about whacking foreskins. I mean, that's just unacceptable. We have the moral high ground, we have the rational arguments, we have the medical basis, so the pro-circers really have little, if anything, to rely on other than misinformation, and that needs to be exposed. And so to the extent I can help with that, I look forward to doing that. I usually keep some circumcision literature in my bag with me, and when I see a pregnant woman, I just hand her a brochure, and normally I get one of two responses. Well, I'm having a girl, in which case I say, well, give this to one of your friends who's having a boy, or I get the response of thank you. So it's like any little difference you can make, some baby someday will give you a silent thank you.